of spiritual warfare.
I don't know if you realize it, but we're at war every day. I mean, some of us are battling physically, you know, just to get out of bed in the morning. For some, it's a challenge. Some emotionally, okay? Some are dealing with grief and pain, things, those sorts of things. Some are just economically, we're battling. How am I going to make it? I mean, there's a lot of battles out there. But the one I want to talk about today is actually spiritual warfare. Spiritual warfare. On top of all those other things that are going on, there is a war. It's been going on from the beginning of time. Back in the Garden of Eden, the serpent came. Behind the serpent was Satan himself, challenging the woman as trying to provoke a battle. And lying to her, and that the warfare has been going on ever since. In fact, it says in 2 Corinthians 10:4, it says this, "For the weapons of our warfare are not merely human, although we do have human things that we do, but they're not merely human, but they have divine power to destroy strongholds." We Christians have a secret weapon. I want to talk about that as we progress through our message today. And we need to be utilizing what we got so that we can have victory. So to do this, I want to talk about principles of spiritual warfare. From the battle that Moses encountered while they were leaving the Exodus and they were making their way down to Mount Sinai to receive the law of God, we find that they didn't have to pick a fight. And you don't either. You don't have a pick a fight because a fight will pick you. If you stand up for the Lord, it will find you. I learned this early on when I was in Bible college. I was working in a factory. I didn't realize it. Really. I told me I was a Baptist Bible College student. Well, not everybody liked Baptist Bible College students. Imagine that. There was one in particular, one guy, he made it his full-time occupation to make my life miserable. You know, my job was tying these strands of fibers to make threads that then they made nylon cords out of that ran in automobile tires, okay? So I wasn't looking, he kept snipping my lines. I have to go retie all those lines. I wasn't looking, he snipped my lines. He was making my life miserable. He did all kinds of nonsense. One day, this is how it all ended. I mean, this went on for some time, but one day he came in wearing a pornographic shirt. The boss was the one who blew his lid dead. He made him take that shirt off, put it inside out, and after that, he got so reprimanded, he was a little afraid of me after that. But you see, there's a conflict that goes on. If you stand up for the Lord, you don't have to pick any fights, they will pick you. They'll come to you. Look what happened. They're going to get the law of God on their journey, having passed through the Red Sea, and they're making their journey down to the mountain of God, and it says here, and the Amalekites, and then Amalek came and fought with Israel at Rephidim. Notice who picked the fight here. It wasn't Israel. So I got this principle. You don't have to pick a fight. The fight will pick you. Next principle. When the fight picks you, you need to have a plan. You need to know what to do. In the New Testament, Peter says, be prepared to give every man a reason or an answer for the hope that you have within you. I am to be ready to give everyone a reason for the hope that I have within me. I need to be prepared. It says here, Moses said to Joshua, choose some men and go out for us. Fight Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on top of the hill with my staff of God in my hand. Listen. Few things here, he says, is what you have to do when you have the plan. You got to choose somebody to engage in a defensive move. This is not an offensive measure. They come and attack you. You've got to have a defense so that you defend yourself. There is a principle within the Word of God, one of our unalienable rights given by us, is the right to defend ourselves. You have the right to defend yourself. When you're being attacked, and you're naturally they're being attacked, he says, now choose some men to go out and fight. Now whenever you choose able people to do that, they've got to engage in the conflict. You don't run from your conflict, you confront your conflict. The third thing I see here is he says, you need a support group. I will stand on the top of the hill with the staff of God in my hand. There is more to it than just the physical engagement. That staff of God was what God had given him to do mighty things. So I'm going to put my trust not just in what I can do, but I'm going to put my trust in what God will do. What God will do. Now, when I have the plan, it's really important that I work the plan. So Joshua did as Moses told him to do. And he fought. He went out and he engaged in the battle as they were coming. He met them with his defensive forces. And it says he fought with them. While Moses and Aaron and Hur, they went up on top of the hill to do their part. And their part was to support him in what he was doing with spiritual strength. They were up there praying. Just jump to the end of the passage. We're going to find they were praying. Listen, folks, this is our secret weapon. We have a weapon the world knows nothing of. It's called prayer. For God's divine intervention. Now he says, once you have the plan, you got to work the plan, but you got to work, find out what works for you. Whenever Moses held up his hands to the Lord, later we'll find him, to put his hand on the throne of God. This is Moses going to the very throne of grace, finding help in the time of need. Whenever Moses held up his hand to the Lord, Israel prevailed. But I don't know about you. We used to do this every now and then. I would have, because the Bible says holding up holy hands in prayer. I tell the congregation, hold up your hands for the prayer, and then I start praying a really long pastoral prayer. And I start including missionaries, you know, I include everything. Those hands are like, people had their hands up. To hold up your hands, you see. He had his hands up, they prevailed. And whenever he lowered his hands, the end of it. Okay? Well, now he's figured out what works. Hey, when I got my hands up and I prayed to the Lord, then we're prevailing. And there's a symbolism here. When I stop relying upon the Lord, alright, I lose. When I rely on the Lord, we're winning. On myself, you lose. And so what they do, they say, well, hey, you've got to do whatever it takes. You do whatever it takes. But Moses' hands grew weary, so they took stones and put them under him, a stone, and he sat on it. And Aaron and Hur held up his hands, one on one side, one on the other side, so that his hands were steady until the sun set. They figured out what worked. He said, I can't do this alone. This might be the first support group in the Bible. You know, sometimes you can't do it on your own. That's why these are so important. You fill out your prayer request because sometimes you need the support of others. You need the support of others. There may come a day when you're so sick you can't even pray for yourself. Who's going to pray? Do you need that support? I think there's a picture being painted here that we need others to join in on our prayer request. So for the much importunity, constantly nagging God, all of us, he'll answer in a mighty powerful way. Because he knows we mean business, because we shared it with others to mean business, and we pray together. That's why our prayer chain is so important. Have a plan, do what it takes. Then you experience the victory. Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the sword. Great victory. First victory coming out was, well, God did it all. The Egyptian army was destroyed at sea. This is the first one where they actually came from the other side and were attacking him. They had victory because the people believed in this power of prayer. The next few verses are kind of curious. The Lord said to Moses, write this as a reminder in a book and recite it in the hearing of Joshua.
down so you don't forget.
Write it down so you can tell Joshua. See, Joshua wasn't up on the hill. He was down in the valley. I know he wasn't looking up. Hey, I wonder what they're doing back there. I mean, that would have been the most foolish thing in the world. So what's Joshua think? Joshua's in the battle and he's thinking, I'm having a great victory. Oh, I got a little setback here, but he's somebody to charge harder and they're fighting. So when he's all done, what's he think?
I had a great victory there, didn't I?
God says, no, write this down and recite it to Joshua. Tell Joshua, you know, when you're having that little retreat there, it's because my hands went down. And God was saying, hey, you gotta lift him up. You gotta depend upon me. And when I raise him up, Joshua, then you had great success. See, Joshua didn't know because he wasn't watching up on the hill. He was fighting the people in front of him. And sometimes afterward, the person's been a coma and comes out, you gotta say, hey, you can't believe this. Everybody we know is praying for you because that person didn't know what the battle was like. You have to recite it. You have to tell them. You have to record it. It's got to be written down. And he says, I want you to do this in the hearing of Joshua, and I will utterly blot out the remembrance of the Amalekites from under heaven. This is a pretty powerful statement. You see, you had a battle today, and you won. It's not the last battle you're going to have. You're in a war. A spiritual war. Good and evil, righteousness and unrighteousness, those who follow God and those who don't. You're going to be attacked again, but a day is coming when they're going to be totally blotted out. And Moses then set up an altar. He says, there's an altar, and I call this an altar of prayer. He sets up an altar. Moses built this altar and he called it, the Lord is my banner. We wave your banner for victory. We won, you know. It's like the flag of Iwo Jima. We put that flag up, you know, that we conquered it. It's our banner. And he's saying, the Lord is my banner. And he said, the hand of the banner of the Lord will give war with Amalek from generation to generation. If you look at other translations, they translate this just a little differently. Moses built an altar. He called it, the Lord is my banner. That part's the same. He said, for the hands were lifted up to the throne of God. Instead of calling this a banner, they understand the Hebrew here just a little differently. That the hands were thrown up to the hand, to the throne of God. And he's saying, this is what really happened, Joshua. While you were battling, we were spiritually battling. And we were breaking through to heaven, invoking God to give the victory. Then he adds, the Lord will be at war against the Amalekites from generation to generation. But why? Why? Why is this going to be from generation to generation? Later, we're going to find in the book of Numbers, if you were continuing on reading through the Old Testament, the Amalek was the first among the nations, but he will come to ruin it last. They were the first nation to come out and oppose Israel on their way, on their journey to the promised land. He says, remember what the Amalekites did when you did to you along the way when you came out of Egypt? They were the first one that came out against you. When you were weary and worn out, they met you on your journey and they cut off all who were lagging behind. They had no fear of God. After they came up and confronted them, that wasn't it. They were wandering through the wilderness trying to make their way to the promised land. And it says here, they cut off all who were lagging behind. The slow, the weak, the elderly, they were waiting and just picking them off. These were like the original terrorists. Small cell groups, attacking people that were defenseless. People that were soft targets. And they did this for the whole journey. They just constant nipping at them, nipping at them, nipping at them. Because of that, there's no fear of God. He says, when the Lord your God gives you rest from all your enemies in the promised land that he's going to give you to possess and inherit, you shall plot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven. Do
not forget.
So,
we need to just fast forward about 400 years.
400 years later, we got they've conquered the land. Israel's had a period of judges to rule in the land. They now call their first king. His name is Saul. Here's Saul. In 1 Samuel chapter 15, Samuel is the prophet of God, and he gives a message. He says this, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, I will punish the Amalekites for what they did in opposing the Israelites when they came up out of Egypt. Now go and attack Amalek and utterly destroy all that they have. Do not spare them." He goes on and enumerates. Don't spare their cattle. Don't spare their families. Don't spare any of their goods. Destroy everything. So Solomon did as he said. He attacked the Amalekites. He took King Agag of the Amalekites alive. But he utterly destroyed the people on the edge of the sword. And Saul and the people spared Agag. You see something? A little problem here? God told him to utterly destroy everyone, and he spared the king. It's not all he spared. He spared his families. In fact, he said, and all the things that were valuable, they would not utterly destroy. This is just a half-hearted commitment to what God wants him to do. It's a life of compromise. It's not wholehearted allegiance, it's partial. I'll do the part that I please to do, but I'm not going to do the part that God wants me to do, but I don't like to do. I wanted to have glory over this king, and I spared him so I could parade him around, and I could show everyone that I'm bigger than the king Agag, and all of that. When Samuel arrives, he says, oh, this is not good. You have disobeyed the Lord. And he said, What is all of this? He said, oh, I have saved the best parts for the Lord. I'm going to sacrifice them unto the Lord. Then you have the statement from Samuel. Does the Lord delight in sacrifices more than he delights in obedience? Does he really want sacrifice in order to fix your sin? Or would he rather you didn't sin at all? You see what I'm saying? One of the kids in the youth group at the previous church said was taking on a retreat. And the cost of the retreat was like $20. And I said, hey, you got money for the retreat? Yeah, I said, have you got extra spending money? He said, oh yeah. I said, I told my mom the retreat was $50. So I got $30 extra to spend. I said, what? That's lying. He said, oh, no, don't worry about it. I already confessed it and asked God to forgive me. Paul addresses that in Romans 5. Shall I sin that grace may abound? Oh, look at, if when I sin makes God gracious to me, shouldn't I sin all the more so God can be more gracious and just make God more gracious? And he says, no way. No way. Saul is saying, he's rationalizing in a faulty, rational way. And he's saying, I saved that which you told me to destroy so that I could use it as an offering unto you. I'm using my disobedience to offer my disobedience unto you, Lord. It just doesn't cut it. And so because of that, and because Samuel is telling him that the Lord is displeased with him, he says, to obey is better than sacrifice. So Saul grabs him by the robe and rips Samuel's robe as Samuel turned away to leave. And he says, as you have torn my robe, so shall the kingdom be torn from you and given to another. And we know who the another was. It was the one after God's own heart, David. He lost the kingdom because of his partial obedience to the Lord. There's always consequences for him. He spared Agag, the king of the Amalekites. Fast forward with me another time. 500 more years. The nation has now gone into captivity. The Assyrians have come and captured Israel. The Babylonians have come and conquered Judah, the southern kingdom. And they're all out of their land.
we know him by Xerxes. The Bible knows him as Ahasuerus. Look at that name, Ahasuerus. I wonder how he got it. Almost sounds like a sneeze. Maybe when he was born, someone went, Ahasuerus. That was his name. But Ahasuerus, Xerxes, is king. He's got a huge kingdom, one of the largest kingdoms ever. He's got a summer palace in Susa. And at the summer palace, he's throwing a big banquet. So it says, after these things, or what are things? These are the things that come after. This comes after. He's throwing this big party. It's like 150 days. I don't know, you can look it up in the first chapter, it gives you the exact number of days. Big party. He summons his wife Vashti to come before him, wearing the crown so she can show her beauty. And she refuses. Verse 11's number right there. She refuses. And all of the people in the government with Xerxes or Ahasuerus said, we can't tolerate this. She's got to be punished. You've got to dispose of her. And so he does. She's thrown out as queen. But now the king has no queen. He said, well, what shall I do? He said, hey, listen, this is what you got to do. You've got to throw a beauty pageant. Then a beauty pageant, get all the most beautiful women. So they do. They have a beauty pageant. Beauty pageant goes on, and they prepare the women for this beauty pageant. And there's a young girl named Hadassah. Her uncle's name is Mordecai. And she's being cared for because they're in captivity. They've been in the captivity for years. And he's established himself, but he's been taking care of his niece, Hadassah. And Hadassah is drop dead gorgeous. So much so that when the actual pageant takes place, she's picked to be the queen. And because she's picked to be the queen, Mordecai the uncle, every day he's spending his time in the gates of the palace because he wanted to keep an eye on his niece. But nobody knows that they're Jewish. Hadassah's name is no longer Hadassah. She has her name changed to Esther. That's the way most of you know her. Hadassah means myrtle. So she went from myrtle. Esther means star. She went from being a myrtle to being a star. And so there she is in the palace, and Mordecai, nobody knows they're Jewish. He's down at the gate, and one day he overhears an assassination plot against Xerxes, Ahasuerus, Esther's husband. And so what he does is he sends a note to Hadassah and Esther and says, listen, there's this assassination plot, gets on foil. Because of that command, they write it down in the annals of the king, and through the annals, said, man, this Mordecai spared the king's life. All right, all that takes place when it says after these things, Ahasuerus promoted Haman the Agagite. Well, wait a minute. Agag the Agagite. Agag is the guy that Saul spared, who was an Amalekite. Who's under the curse goes all the way back to this passage right in Moses. There's a spiritual war going on. It's going to unfold right here before our eyes in this little book of Esther. Haman the Agagite says to the king, there's a certain people who want to know why? Because whenever Haman would go out of the city gates, everybody bowed down to him except for one guy. Mordecai just stood there. He was Jewish. Can't bow down to somebody else because you can't make an idol of any man. So he doesn't bow down to him. And then when he asks why is he not bowing down, it's irritating Haman because Haman has risen. He is like the vice president, the vice king in Persia. He's second in command. And he can't believe that he's not bowing down. He cries out because he says he's Jewish and he can't do it because of his religion. And so when he does, he says there's this people in the kingdom that won't bow down and they observe other customs and laws and they oppose the king. And king, you know what I'll do? If you read down here, it says, if it pleases the king, let a decree be issued for their destruction. And they're a nuisance anyway. And I will pay 10,000 talents of silver. Now I'm telling you something, that's a chunk of money. In today's dollars, it's $150 million. He really did not like Mordecai. Get the picture. Mordecai's only offense is he just didn't bow down when he went by.
difference was I went to Baptist Bible College. You get the picture? There's Mordecai. He finds out this edict. The king actually signs it. They cast lots to pick the day. That's called Pur in the Persian. Pur. And so later this, the holy event will be called Purim. And they still celebrate the rescue of this to this day. They cast lot for the date. When the date was found, it posted it on a certain date that all the Jews would be eliminated. And Mordecai rips his clothes, puts on sackcloth and ashes. And he's sitting in ashes and throwing on himself an act of profound repentance and humiliation and prayerfulness and condition before God. And he goes and he sits in the gate in this condition. And Hadassah is mortified. My uncle, the one who raised me, he's in this condition. She sends a message out to him and says, listen, what's wrong? He sends back the decree with a note saying, listen, Hadassah, Esther, you need to go before the king and you need to tell him that this has got to be changed. But it was written in the law of the Medes and the Persians, which could never be altered. But she said, you got to do something. And she sends back a note saying, listen, I can't do anything. You can't just go before the king. You got to go when he summons you. He hasn't summoned me for a month. If I go in, I'm like Vashti. I'm being disobedient to the laws of the land. If I go in, it could be, you know, I can't do this. And so he writes back and he says, listen, don't think you're any different than the rest of us. You're Jewish. You're under this edict too. And who knows? Perhaps God has raised you up for such a time as this. Spiritual warfare. Sometimes you got to go out and you got to confront the enemy. Spiritual warfare. Perhaps God puts you where you're at with the people you're facing for such a time as this. She agrees to do it. So the next chapter of the book tells us that she went in before the king. The king raised his scepter, saying it's okay to come in. Woo! I bet she dolled herself up really good that day. He says, come on in. He says, what do you want? I'll give you up to half my kingdom. Whoa! She must have looked really drop-dead gorgeous that day. That's all I can think of. She says, this is it. I request for you to come to a banquet that I have for you. Oh, and bring Haman along. Bring him along. And it's a Saturday. Oh, okay. So he grabs Haman. They go along. She throws his banquet for them. And the king says, okay, what do you want? I'll give you up to half my kingdom. And she says, well, listen, if I've really found favor in your sight, I would like you to come to a banquet tomorrow where I'll tell you what I really like. And the king's thinking, oh, she's really going to give this a thought. Right? And so they go scurrying out of there. And while they go scurrying out of there, Haman is so excited. He's just had private dinner with the king and the queen and been invited to another one. Nobody else is invited, just him. And on his way out, he sees that little lowlife, no good, Mordecai, standing up tall while everybody else is bowing down. And it ruined his whole day. He gets home and he tells his wife about what he did. That little guy didn't, he just stood there with his black beady eyes staring at me and he didn't bow down. And she said, well, you know what you need to do? Build some gallows, make some good ones, 75 feet high, and then hang that guy on those gallows. That'll take care of him. That'll show everybody who's boss around here. The idea pleased him. He sent out the carpenters, and they began immediately building them. But I don't know if that's why that night the king could not sleep. He wakes up. I can imagine. Out in the court, they're pounding away, building, getting fires all around so they can see they're building these gallows. He's really after this Mordecai. He's going to get him. King can't sleep. He gets up in the middle of the night. He says, guys, I can't sleep. Well, that'll do what you do. You turn on TV, you get a book out. He says, hey, get out the annals of the king. So they get out the annals and they start reading. The place they open up to is about, hey, there was an assassination plot. The guy by the name of Mordecai. He saved your life. He said, well, what's been done for Mordecai? He said, well, nothing. Well, it's getting to be about daylight. He says, well, is there any of my council in the courtyard? He said, well, oh, hey, look, here comes Haman. And so he comes, and Haman comes in, and he says, Haman. He says, hey, what should the king do for the man he really wants to honor, in whom he really delights? Now Haman's thinking it's all about him. And so he says, well, this is what you do. You take the king's finest, one of the crowns that he's worn, put it on his head. You take one of the king's robes and you put it on. Put it on one of the king's horses. And then take one of your highest official and take that horse and lead it through the courtyards of the city, declaring, this is how the king wants to honor the man who has done him a favor. And King Xerxes, he looks right into David's eyes and says, go do what you just said to Mordecai. Oh my goodness. He goes walking through the city. This is what the king does to the guy he really delights in. Can you just see it? Well, by the time he gets there, he goes home and tells his wife, oh my goodness. He said, listen. She says, I don't know. I think things have turned on you. This could be the beginning of your downfall. Just then, he's interrupted at home and said, hey, it's time to go to the banquet. The queen has revealed the king. So he rushes off to the banquet, gets to the banquet, and there we are. Dining. Well, they have a dining room, we do. That big round couch with the food in the middle, and you kind of recline and you lean, and you on one elbow, and you pick with the other one, and you're reclining around this table, and they're eating, and finally, as they're eating, and they're having this banquet, the king looks at Esther and says, Esther, what would you like up to half of the kingdom? And Esther says, my people have been treated like slaves. We've been bought, and said, if that's all it was, I would not even bring this up to you, king. But there is an individual who wants to annihilate us and destroy us and to kill us. And the king is outraged. He just can't believe it. Who's done this? Who could have done such a thing? And she looks over at Haman and says, that's the man. The king now is so distraught, he gets up, he leaves the room. Haman knows he's done. So he lunges across the lounge so he can get right face to face with Esther. Just, and he's begging for his life, just as the king comes back and says, is it enough that you wanted to kill all of her people, but you want to assault the queen too? He sees that he's trying to do something to her. And so they said, what can I do for him? They said, well, you know, Haman's building some gallows out in the courtyard to hang Mordecai on. And he said, hang Haman on his own gallows. Why tell this story? So they hanged Haman on the gallows that he had prepared for Mordecai. You go a few more chapters back and it says, chapter 9, it says, and the Jews struck down all their enemies with the sword. The way they got around it, King Xerxes made a decree that the Jewish people could defend themselves. So the few that did try to attack, they were destroyed. It tells you how many thousands were destroyed on that day, but they weren't the Jews. They finished off the enemy of God, the Amalekites. There are no more Amalekites after this day. It totally backfired. Listen, I'm saying all this. Here's the point. For whatever was written in the former days, it says in the book of Romans, was written for our instruction. So that the steadfastness, by the steadfastness and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. All these stories in the Old Testament are illustrative of what God does. They teach us about spiritual warfare in the situation. When I go to the book of Ephesians, it says this, therefore, take up the whole armor of God. We have an armor. He says, we wrestle not with just flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. Those are names of invisible angelic armies. Principalities, powers, spiritual wickedness in high places. That's what we really are fighting against. He says, therefore, take the whole armor of God so that you may be able to withstand on the evil day and having done everything to stand firm. What is the armor? The helmet of salvation. The shoes of the preparation of the gospel of peace. The loins is protected by a belt of truth. There is a shield of faith. There's a breastplate of righteousness. There's a sword of the Spirit. You've got everything. All of it is protective except for one thing, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Everything else in my faith protects me. So if I'm going to do spiritual battle, I've got to be saved, have a helmet of salvation. I've got to know the gospel. I've got
gospel is the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ.
I've got to have the belt of the truth. Jesus said, I am the truth. I've got to have a breastplate of righteousness. Christ is our righteousness. I've got to be shielded with my shield of faith. You see, I have all of this. This is all defense. I rely upon my relationship with Jesus Christ. I hand my hands up to God and say, I can't do it without you. I can't do it without you. I can't do it without you.
The only offensive piece is the Word of God. The Word of God.
So I must learn the Word so I can use the Word, because it's the only thing that's going to be my offensive piece of equipment to make my battle go forward and not just constantly defending myself and going backwards. I must know the Scripture. Now, having all of that, the Bible says this. You got all that equipment. Here's how you use it. You pray. See, Joshua was down in the battle using all the equipment. Moses was up on the mountain praying. God says to us, hey, listen, I've given you all this equipment. The way you use it, you are in constant prayer. Listen, pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer, and every supplication. Supplication is the word for prayer. Prayer is mentioned 3 times in this verse because he says, the way you use your faith is that you pray. The poet put it this way. I had a battle fierce today within my place of prayer. I went to meet and talk with God, but I found Satan there. He said, you can't really pray. You lost not long ago. You may say words all on your knees, but you can't pray, you know. So then I pulled my helmet down, way down from my ears. I found it helped distill his voice, helped delay my fears. I checked my other arm roar. Oh, my feet in peace were shot. My loins with truth were girt around. My sword, the word of God. My righteous breastplate still was on. My heart slept to protect. My shield of faith was still intact. His fiery darts bounced back. So then I prayed in Jesus' name and I pled the precious blood. While Satan sneaked away in shame, I meant to talk with God. We've got to pray. We've got all the spiritual armament, but the way that we use it is that we pray. We pray for that. That's what we want to do now. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we are a people who come to you confessing we don't pray like we want. We have more excuses, Lord, than perhaps any other generation. We are just too busy. Teach us, Lord, that we can watch and pray. Even when we're driving down the road, we can be lifting up our voice to you. Teach us, O Lord, how to go into our closet in privacy and pray, taking our most important requests unto you. Teach us, Lord, that there is nothing so small that we can't pray for it, and nothing too big that you can't answer. Teach us to pray, Lord. The art we know of spiritual warfare is not on all the equipment we have, but just on the attitude of prayer. Make us a praying people. For this I pray, in Jesus' name.